This episode was made possible by generous supporters on Patreon.
Hey, crazies. In the previous video, we learned what electric charge really was. A measure of how much something can affect the electric field. So the next logical question is, does the magnetic field work the same way? Is there some kind of magnetic charge that affects the magnetic field? That would be nice, but it's a little more complicated than that. No, the magnetic field is affected by the same thing as the electric field. Electric charge. This proton has a positive electric charge. If it's sitting still, then only the electric field is affected. But if it moves, it can also affect the magnetic field. The orange X's and dots represent direction into and out of your screen, because that's what a simple arrow would look like in each of those cases. We can see the moving proton affects both fields. Historically though, we don't do experiments with single charge particles. So while this diagram is accurate, it's not very practical. We usually have a bunch of charges moving together in something we call a current. To the timeline! In 1819, Hans Christian Oersted noticed that magnetic compasses deflected near a current-carrying wire. Kind of like this. On, off, on, off, on, off. Then in 1820, Jean-Baptiste Biot and Félix Savart found a simple pattern for this. But then Pierre-Simon Laplace almost immediately generalized it. Because, you know, mathematicians are like that. Side note, Laplace was a BAMF. Seriously, he was like 70 by the time he did this. To honor Laplace for his hard work, we named his law Laplace's Law. Just kidding, it's called the Biot-Savart Law. What? His name isn't even on it? Yeah, I know, it totally sucks, but in all fairness, the man has plenty of stuff named after him. He doesn't really need it. Even electrodynamics, the topic of this series, has a Laplace's equation. He did a lot of stuff in his life. End of side note. The point is, magnetism appears when charge moves. It doesn't matter if it's a single charge or a whole bunch of charges moving through a long wire. It doesn't even matter how that wire is shaped. Moving charge affects the magnetic field.
Sure, that's true for electromagnets, but that doesn't really explain this.
Are you really gonna make me go there?
Yes, the crazies are gonna like it.
Okay, I can do this. We have what seems to be two different kinds of magnets. An electromagnet and what we call a permanent magnet. But in the end, we'll see that both types of magnets are really caused by the same thing. Let's start with the names. An electromagnet is a magnet created by electricity. There isn't any electric current running through a magnet like this though, so it seemed like it should go by a different name. We went with permanent magnet because we thought they lasted forever. Over time though, they can lose their magnetism, especially if they get hot. But left to their own devices, that process could easily take thousands of years. Compared to a human lifespan, it still seems like forever. Anyway, it's the name we're stuck with. Now for the basic properties. Based on the shape of the magnetic field, we notice there are two opposite sources. We call those sources poles and label them north and south. Why we use those labels has to do with Earth's magnetic field, but that's a topic for another day. All permanent magnets have at least one north pole and one south pole. Even electromagnets have poles if they're shaped certain ways. Sometimes magnets have more than one set of poles, but they always come in pairs. Always. It's a behavior summed up pretty well with Gauss's law for magnetism. So how is a piece of material magnetic if there's no electric current? Quantum mechanics. Hold on to your butts. To understand how something like this can be a magnet, we need to look closer, a lot closer. Super zoom. This is what a chunk of iron looks like on a molecular level. Yet, we still don't see any moving charges. For that, we have to zoom in one more step. This cloud of negative charge is made of 26 electrons. Each of those electrons is in something called an orbital. Those come in a variety of shapes, each with a set of available properties. But we need to be careful. Quantum particles can have all sorts of properties. Position, energy, linear momentum, angular momentum, all the properties. The property the electrons have in these orbitals is angular momentum. In fact, we can measure both the total amount and the orientation, at least along one direction. Just having that property is enough to make it a tiny magnet. Any electron with a non-zero angular momentum will act like a tiny magnet. Unfortunately, that doesn't necessarily turn the entire iron atom into a magnet, because electrons tend to pair up in opposite directions. There are 26 electrons in an iron atom. For each one that's in a clockwise orbital, there's another one that's in a counterclockwise orbital. They cancel each other out. So this level of existence isn't deep enough. We need to zoom in even closer. This single electron has an inherent property called spin angular momentum. That's something we talked a lot about in this video. It's not really a motion, but it is momentum, and that's enough for magnetism. When you zoom back out to the atomic level, most of those electrons still pair up and cancel, except four of them. Because like charges repel, they get as far from each other as possible and line up in the same direction, at least in iron. The more of those loner electrons an atom has lined up, the more magnetic it's going to be. That tends to happen in the middle of blocks on the periodic table. But just because an atom is magnetic, it doesn't necessarily mean the material is magnetic. Don't ever jump to conclusions in quantum mechanics. Getting the loner electrons to line up isn't enough. You also have to get nearby atoms to line up with each other, and then get enough regions of atoms to line up. We call those regions domains. The point is, magnetic materials are hard to come by. In fact, there are only four elements that do this at room temperature: iron, cobalt, nickel, and gadolinium. Beyond that, we either need to get the material really cold or build the material using a specially designed molecule. Or both. So what the heck is a magnet? Magnets are what you get when charges move, or at least have momentum. That's true if you're talking about a single charge, a bunch of charges in a current, or even the spin of subatomic charges in a piece of iron. All magnets come from charges, so all magnets are electromagnets. Wicked, huh? So, how fascinated are you by magnets? Let us know in the comments. Thanks for liking and sharing this video. Don't forget to subscribe if you'd like to keep up with us. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. In the last video, a big question was, why do particles have the specific charges that they do? Well, we don't know. Those charges have to be measured and then put into the standard model. We haven't found an underlying mechanism yet. Anyway, thanks for watching.